Welcome to Selectmen's Meeting, March 27th, 2017. Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance and remain standing afterwards for a moment of silence.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to have a moment of silence for a former Abington resident and dear friend, Rob Cunningham, who recently passed away. Sadly, Rob leaves behind his wife, Jen, and two children. Rob was on the Finance Committee in Abington for many years, was also the chairman of the Mass Republican State Party, campaign manager for Senator Scott Brown, and for Governor Charlie Baker. Rob will be deeply missed by his loving family and many friends. Thank you. Actually, we already hit a schedule, so public announcements. Forgot about that important part. Bob.
Thank you. I have two. Rabies clinic. I'd like you to know that the Board of Health will be holding a rabies clinic at the Town Hall from 10 to 12 p.m. on April 8th. The cost is $10 to vaccinate your dogs and cats. The town clerk will be available also for licensing your dog. Again, that's 10 to 12 noon on April 8th. The cost is $10. It's vaccination for cats and dogs, and you can also register and get your dog's tags at the same time when the town clerk will be available. The other public announcement has to do with our compost site. The compost site at 171 Groveland Street is open most Saturdays from 9 to 2, April 1st to November 25th, and that's basically based on the volunteers that are available to staff it. So when we don't have enough adequate staff, we can't keep it open. We need two people are needed on each Saturday. We currently have three regular senior program workers and two volunteers, which will cover 53 of the 60 spots that are necessary to be open for a minimum of 30 days. What they are looking for are volunteers to fill those 7 days. However, more than seven would mean more days that we could open the compost site. The volunteers would be paired with a seasonal sitter and would be there in case of emergency situation and to assist the regular workers and hopefully help answer any questions people may have. There is no heavy lifting or unloading of cars, unless, of course, there's a handicapped person, which we all jump in and volunteer. Most sitters enjoy the social aspect of sitting and being out in the sunshine. It's a nice way to meet your neighbors and friends as they come in and drop off their leaves and shrubbery and other things. There is a large container for shelter in most cases if it starts to rain. Anyone interested can contact the Board of Health's office, specifically Lorraine, at 781-982-2119 from 8:30 to 11 a.m. Monday through Thursday. The days open can be moved, but during the months of June through November, volunteers would let them know what day is available. So we're not asking you to pinpoint whatever days you can give to the compost site would be more than welcome. And the more volunteers we get, the more days we can stay open, and the longer we can stay open. So please reach out to Lorraine and see if you can volunteer. That phone number again is 781-982-2119 from 8 to 11, Monday through Thursday. Ask for Lorraine. Thank you.
Before, Alex, I want to apologize for the length of the meeting already. We're behind schedule because that announcement was so long. But go ahead, Alex.
Do I have time for mine?
I hope so.
Keep it short, will you?
The Hug Foundation will be holding their annual Bruins alumni hockey game again this year at the Rockland Ice Rink. We typically do it in January, but we changed it to April 15th this year at 1 o'clock at the Rockland Ice Rink, and we changed it to that date because Ray Bork is available to come down and play. So it's worth the admission price just to see Ray. Tickets are $15 for adults, and they're $5 for kids 12 and under. And there will be an after party at the Polish Club immediately after the game. There will be food, music, raffles, and the Bruins alumni there also. Those tickets are only $20 per person. Tickets are available at the door, and they're available online at Eventbrite and through the Hug Foundation Facebook page and several businesses around town. You might have seen the posters. Any place there's a poster, they are selling tickets for us. So hopefully you all come out. This is the Hug Foundation's largest event every year. So please come out and support us.
Andy?
The Friends of the Abington Library 40th Annual Book Sale will be held on Friday, April 28th from 12:30 to 4:30 p.m. and on Saturday, April 29th, from 10 a.m. to 3 o'clock p.m. in the Copeland Room of the Abington Public Library. And they're also looking for donations for the sale. Donations of new and used hard-covered adult and children's books will be accepted beginning Tuesday, March 28th at the library. Fiction and nonfiction books in good condition, hobby books, and puzzles, CDs, and DVDs may be left at the library. For more information, you can contact the library directly, 781-982-2139, or via email at ablib@ocln.org.
My announcement, the title is Oh for the Love of Food. Abington Celebrates Committee, which we're all pretty much members of, is happy to announce the launch of a community cookbook affectionately called Abington Celebrates Hometown Cooking. We know that food brings people together, and what better way to bring our community together than sharing food? Together we can make this one incredible book to treasure. Have a favorite recipe to share? Great. We would love it. We hope to hear from residents, groups, church, locals, clubs, etc., and, appropriately enough, local restaurants. I think we have three of them here tonight. In addition, if you have a fun fact or a bit of history to share about the recipe, we would love that too. Our hope is that the cookbook is not only versatile, but will also be a great keepsake to pass along to future generations. Please send recipes by May 15th to abingtoncelebratesfood@gmail.com or there's a box here at the Town Hall, 500 Glendowitz Way, Abington Celebrates box. So keep an eye out for information on ordering cookbooks as well as advertising as things heat up. Get it? Food? Okay.
Did you write that?
No.
I didn't think so.
At 6:35, we have a hearing, public hearing, so I will entertain a motion to hold a public hearing on the application of Andrea Schnell, 1400 Bedford Street, Sorrel Bar and Grill for alteration of premise.
Motion to open the meeting for said sole premises? First, they have premises.
Purpose.
Said sole purpose.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, we'll have a public hearing. Is Andrea present?
Yes.
Would you like to come up to the microphone? Absolutely. Thank you. I just did. I have to read that. I'll read the whole notice. Thank you. The Board of Selectmen will hold a public hearing on Monday, March 27, 2017 at 6:35, the Carter Hearing Room, 500 Glenoaks Way, on the application of Andrea Schnell, 1400 Bedford Street, Sorrel Bar and Grill, Inc., for alteration of premise. You want to tell us a little bit about what you've got planned? I know we have diagrams and everything, but...
Yeah, we're looking to amend our current liquor license to accommodate our small dining patios. A 30-seat patio, a larger seat patio on the, I guess that's the southern side, and a smaller 8-seat patio on the front of the building.
Okay, everybody's got the diagram, so we know what you're talking about. I actually spoke to some of the neighbors, and they said that you've been very cooperative and you've met with the neighbors, and
absolutely.
You had to go before another board before this, too, correct?
Yes, planning and conservation.
Okay. Well, I'll take questions from the board first. Anybody has any questions for Andrea?
Just, was this something you had not anticipated putting on and decided to put on after
the
fact?
It was like everything with this project. Things went on the burner and off the burner and back on and off again. But we think it'll be a great addition.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions from the board?
No.
Is there a bar out there? Or
no.
Just food?
Just
but
food. Just dinner. Yeah, there's no drinking on the patio unless you have dinner.
Right, yeah.
And I think I overheard from some of the neighbors there's basically not much noise out there. TVs?
No.
No, okay.
No.
No music or anything like that. It's just
right.
Just eating your delicious
just
food.
Just dinner, low lights.
Okay, perfect.
Are you going to have a canopy over it? Or is it
We don't have one right now. We did put in a 6-foot privacy fence, but it's something that we will maybe entertain.
Okay, thanks.
No problem.
Anybody have any other questions?
I don't know.
All right, then I guess I will make a motion and close. I do have one question that everybody's going on. No, you're on TV. When are you going to open?
Our grand opening is April 4th.
Excellent. Okay, great news.
Open until the floor.
Should we close the hearing first and then?
No.
Okay, anybody have questions or comments? You want to come up and state your name and...
Great, Bob. How are you doing?
Good, thanks. Bob Graham, 43 Vineyard Road. I was just wondering on the time of the serving the alcohol, like what time would the, you know, like with the dinner.
Right.
What time would the time be to, you know, stop serving alcohol on the patio?
So dinner services, so sorry, I'll get back on my mic. Dinner services is, you know, 5 to 10. So, you know, there could be people out there, I suppose, as late as 10:30. Okay. But, you know, I just want to make sure people understand it's not a drinking crowd. There's no Jello shots or pitchers of beer. It's just fine dining dinner.
Okay. Right.
So 10:30, yeah.
Thank you.
And it just so you know, Andrea, I know the planning board had voted that there should be no alcohol served on the deck after 10.
Okay.
That, yeah, that was part of their,
sure,
their vote. So
sure,
that's built into it. So that would have to be.
Absolutely, yep.
10.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Come on up, please.
Hey, Kathy, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Good, good.
It definitely sounds like you talked to your neighbors, so that's
absolutely
good.
We've been at a couple of neighbors.
Board meetings. Hi, my name is Kathy Creighton, 53 Vineyard Road. And, you know, I think our only concern was the noise, yeah, from the patios, because we, both the Grahams and us, and there's a neighbor that lives directly across the street. So I think the planning board put in their conditions, but it sounded like you guys needed to do it too, that no TVs, no entertainment out there.
There will be no TV, audio, music, or entertainment on the deck.
Okay, yeah. I just wanted to confirm that.
That will all be incorporated, yes.
Perfect, thank you. That was all. Thanks.
Thank you.
No problem.
Anybody else have any comments, questions? I'll make a motion to close the hearing.
Motion to close the hearing.
Okay. Motion made and seconded, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody want to act upon this?
I'll make a motion to approve with the planning board's conditions.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Thank you. Have a good day. Thanks, I'll talk to you soon.
6:45, we can probably take it early, right, because it's not a public hearing.
Thanks.
6:45? New poll? Oh, it is a public hearing. It is a public hearing. Okay, then we can take...
You're too fast.
I know, I love
Wait,
it.
Wait, first of all, I was long-winded. Now we're too fast?
Yeah.
What's up with that?
Okay. What's item number one? Request for school department to... Action number one, approve request of school department to identify Cisco phone systems for proprietary procurement. Do you want to speak upon that? At all, Rick? I know we're jumping ahead, but you told me I only have 45 minutes for the whole meeting, so.
I'm sorry, you're way ahead of me.
You have any public school?
Okay, yeah.
Oh, perfect.
Perfect. Oh,
thank you.
Wow.
Perfect.
Rick got an out.
I'm still getting through the maps thank of you. The poll location hearing here. Okay, thank you. Excellent timing, sir.
Welcome. I'm Rich Bykowski. I'm the IT director for the school system.
Okay.
There should be a letter in your packet regarding the request. Basically, the school system has, over the past 8 years, spent a significant amount of time and finances building out the infrastructure for our IP phone system. The system that we currently use is a Cisco system. As we're building a new building, it gives us the opportunity to continue using that system, and basically after looking at some other systems and understanding the system that we have, we believe it's in our best interest, both technically and financially, to stick with the Cisco system, and so we're asking for a vote for a proprietary spec for that system in regards to the building of the school project.
Mm-hmm. Questions from the board?
It's Cisco is the existing system as
yes.
we speak right now?
That's currently what we have, yes.
And you're happy with it?
Yes, it's rock solid. We've been happy with it. Our staff members are very familiar with it. I've been in Abington for 3 years now, and I've never had an issue with it outside of our outside phone vendor that we get the service from. The internal system has been rock solid.
This may sound like a naive question. Now, why does it come before our board? You know,
I think it's a 30B procurement rule that has to come before your board.
Yes.
Otherwise, they'd have to go out and get the three bids, I believe. Is that
we still do need to do that,
oh, you do.
But this allows us to specify that we want to get a Cisco system.
Right. It's they're bidding a Cisco product, but rather than having,
so any Cisco vendor can bid on it. But okay.
Yes.
All right. Any other questions from the board? I'll entertain a motion.
Motion to approve the use of the Cisco phone system for proprietary procurement for the new pre-K middle high school facility.
Second.
Motion's made in second. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, we're back on schedule.
Okay, 6:45. We have a public hearing. The town of Abington will hold a public hearing on Monday, March 27th, 2017 at 6:45 in the Carter Hearing Room, 500 Glenwood's Way, on the application of National Grid and Verizon for installation of a new pole and anchor in place of a tree that is supporting the existing electrical infrastructure on Jefferson Street, pole 20-89, house number 52, Board of Selectmen. Do you have somebody from National Grid or Verizon?
Yes, we do.
Come on down. Now, there is a map here, so I've figured out where it is. It's actually right next to McKenna's house. But do you want to speak upon this, sir?
Yeah.
And your name?
My name's Simon Young. I'm an electrical distribution engineer for National Grid.
Okay.
Our office is at 100 East Ashland Street, Brockton.
Okay.
And so, like you said briefly, this is going to be for customer purpose. They're going to be removing some of the trees in their back yard. I expect them to kind of expand their parking lot. Okay. And this new pole that we're proposing is going to be in place of the tree that is currently supporting the guy that is in that corner pole right on the corner of 52 Jefferson Street. And this pole, this new pole, will be outside of the fence that is currently bordering 200 Wales Street.
Okay. Okay, the map's in there, what we're talking about.
I can give you mine.
Everybody knows where Jefferson Street is, right?
Is the pole on private property, or is the pole on town property?
Town property. The 200 Wales Street, they have their lots
pole, right?
Fenced out.
Because we're replacing the guy from the tree into
correct.
The pole, correct?
Correct.
I assume public safety and everyone's on board on this?
Yes.
Any other questions?
I did have one. On the petition itself, it states your petitioners, which would be you folks, agree to reserve space for one cross arm, at a suitable point on each side of the poles for the fire, police department, telephone, telegraph signals. But that's, I didn't see that included in the actual order.
This one won't have a cross arm included in it. It will just have a support, just a straight up pole for the guy wire.
Would that be for police, fire?
They won't, let's say that is mainly for, let's say, distribution lines. That kind of requirement is for the cross arm, so they get basically space to work around.
Okay.
If we get up there.
I was just curious why it was in the petition itself, but not included.
Maybe
in the
it's
order.
A, let's say, copyright. It just passes
thing?
On from one to
the
other.
They're not seeking that at that location anyway.
They would not in the future?
Yeah, but,
okay.
Any other questions? I'll entertain a motion. Oh, I'm sorry. It is a public hearing. You are correct. Can you please come up to a microphone, please, just so and state. You could all come up if you want.
We two are the abutters.
Okay.
Of the property.
Oh, go ahead. Just so people out there can know your address, if you could, and where you folks live.
We two are the. He's on one corner of Jefferson and Railroad, and I with a partner own the property on the other corner.
Okay.
I think the current situation is extremely hazardous, and I've been lobbying for a couple of years to have this pole put in. The pole is a pole to run a guy wire from the big three-phase line that runs on a corner, and it needs to be guyed off, and it has one pole guying it off by the railroad tracks, and it has another and on the other side. There are guy wires running to a very elderly tree on my property, and we would very much like to take the tree down. It has some really dead branches, which are overhanging Railroad Street, and they've probably been killed by the guy wires. There's no easement that I know of for National Grid to come onto the property to put it in. The tree is going to come down at some point, and it'll put out power for probably 1,000 houses in big three-phase 15,000 volt line,
that's
probably 1,000 houses in Abington, and plus the tree could fall, and we know what can happen when a big branch falls on the public right away. So I think it's a hazardous condition, and the pole needs to go in, and it needs to go in as quickly as possible.
Absolutely.
But the tree needs to come down.
tree needs to come down.
A piece of the tree's already fallen down on the steel fence on the pipe about this big around and bent it down like this.
But the tree's on town-owned property, correct?
No, the tree is on
Your property.
On my property. I would say that National Grid is responsible for damaging the tree because it's rotted up from the bolts.
That's between you and National Grid.
But it's not a tenable situation.
Well, you know, it hangs right over the street.
Yeah.
I mean, and there's one piece already fell off, probably 12 inches in diameter. It belt us, you know, bent the steel pole, so.
Could we have our DPW director maybe work on this if it overhangs the street?
Is it on town property or not?
No, but the branch.
The tree is not on town property.
It's on his property.
It's on my property.
But it's Verizon that, or whoever put the guy wire through his tree, now the tree's dead. This is the problem.
Do we want to make a contingent upon?
Yeah, let's, I think that's between,
this
is a poll here.
This is.
Unless there, it's a hazard situation where overhanging branches onto the road, that's a different story.
I would just think if we keep this to the matter at hand.
Yes.
Like, that would be the best for the moment.
Yeah, I think we both decided that the pole is necessary.
The pole is very necessary.
Absolutely.
Right.
Of course, we'll get it as quickly as possible after this hearing. Hopefully it gets accepted today, and then we'll push through the scheduling.
Okay.
Yeah.
On putting the pole in.
Yes.
But nothing on the tree itself.
The guy wire from the tree will be removed.
But what about the dead limbs coming off the tree that are hanging over Railroad Street? That's my concern.
Right, if they're hanging over the street, then we have, right, I'm speaking for my.
I think that's.
I mean, what he's saying is that the tree is probably dead from the guy wire being through the tree.
Who's saying that?
Property owner.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's a, I will take it down regardless of who pays for it, but I would just as soon not have to spend $2,000 for some damage that National Grid did. That's all. It was, yeah, anyway.
Could you guys just give your names? I don't think you.
It's an accident waiting to happen is what it is.
Could you guys just give your names for the record?
Yeah, I don't know that we got, for the minutes of the meeting, I don't think we.
Your name?
Butters?
I'm in the butter.
No, but I mean, for the three of the meeting, I don't know that you had announced your names for the meeting.
Donald Pape.
Thank you.
Okay.
44 Jefferson Street.
Okay.
Okay, are you Mr. McKenna?
No.
No.
I know, he's Andrew Dixon.
Andrew Dixon, okay. Just want to make sure we got it for the record of the meeting. That's okay. Thank you. Thank you, yes.
Motion to approve.
Anybody?
Just, so how long do you think it will be before you actually have the pole up?
I think there's not much requirements. I think we do the dig safe, which will take about a week, and then it'll go straight to scheduling. And then, depending on the workload, I think it's pretty clear, let's say, like, pretty straightforward and easy job for probably just two linemen to just go out there. It shouldn't be over a month. It should be within the month.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Anybody else want to talk, speak in the crowd? Okay. I called you guys a crowd. I'll entertain a motion.
Motion to approve the installation of a pole to satisfy the need for the National Grid to power line to be safe on that street.
Second.
We made it second. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Still ahead of schedule.
We're still ahead of schedule. We'll go down to number two. Minutes, February 27th, open session minutes. Thank you. And February 27th, executive session minutes.
Number two, the action.
Thank you.
Very difficult to keep finding all these pages, you know, when you jump out of order.
Well, if you read your agenda ahead of time, you already know that these minutes are awesome.
Perfect. So I'll make a motion to approve the minutes of the regular session, February 27th.
Do I have a second on the motions for minutes of February 27th?
Second.
Regular.
Regular.
Open session.
Motion's made and seconded. All in any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And now we have executive session for the same day.
We approve the
minutes not to be released until all matters are resolved.
Motion's made.
Second.
And seconded. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous. February 27th is two. Do we want to go to appointments? We can probably do that pretty quick, right? Mm-hmm. Number three, appointments to the Surplus School Building Committee. Jared Driscoll, I believe, is here. Would you like to come up to the microphone? Sure. I'll make it easier for you, too. Okay. Jared Driscoll, 164 Myers Ave, Abington, Mass. Now, you actually applied for the Open Space Committee, but you're happy to be on this new...
I did. I spoke with Dory via email, and she was understanding of what my intention was, and she recommended this committee.
Now, you look familiar. You are one of
I
the
should
new,
look
new
familiar.
Firefighters?
I am a firefighter.
That's what I thought. No, you guys have been busy lately.
I usually see you at Trukey's, though, so that's a good thing.
Thanks for the plug.
Yeah,
my God.
Appreciate that. Now, this is the new committee that we have formed, and I actually, five members, I believe. Two
is
or three
that
citizens
what we
at large?
Asked for five?
I think two citizens at large.
Yep.
And one selectman.
Selectman.
I forget now.
And then there was a builder.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, someone with building experience, right?
Real estate experience.
It was it's in the minutes you guys just approved, so.
Yeah.
Member of the Board of Selectmen, the commercial realtor, commercial developer, two residents.
Okay, and you were the resident. Okay, anyone have any questions for Jared or any comments at all?
Just thank you for volunteering.
Hey, no problem.
I want to entertain a motion to appoint Jared Driscoll to the Surplus School Building Committee.
So voted.
Made and seconded. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Look forward
Thank
to
you.
It.
Thank you.
So have we received any other applications, or is this?
No, but we received a phone call today, and so I advised him to send an application. So there will be a second one coming for resident.
Okay. Great.
Now, I just misplaced my agenda because I'm flying through this meeting.
We'll go back to number four, then.
What is it?
Number four?
No, we go back to...
We still have time before our next hearing at 7 o'clock.
Appointment to the SAGE.
Appointment to the SAGE Committee. How many openings are on there, do we know, on the SAGE Committee?
I believe with these it would be four.
I think there's three right now.
We have, and do we want to bring these people up to the microphone so they get their 5 minutes of fame?
Sure.
Excellent. Mary, if they're here, Mary Breen, Bruce Krupnik, and Marianne Papacino?
Papacino.
All right, awesome. I got it right.
Very good.
Bruce couldn't make it tonight.
Two out of three ain't bad.
He is interested.
So, like well, you guys get extra questions now, Esther.
I saw him up over here.
Did you?
Welcome. Thank you for volunteering again. Do you want to just briefly, tell us why you want to be on the SAGE committee? Would you like to do that? Well, actually, would you do that?
Sure. I've been a resident of Abington for at least 6 years in April.
Mm-hmm.
I've gone to your fundraiser, anything with a plug, and thought a great thing.
Very popular.
And I think one you had previous, maybe a few years before that.
Okay.
I'm kind of interested in the recycling because I lived in a condo in Rockland and we had no recycling whatsoever. We just had a big old dumpster, so it was all new to me. So this is,
Great.
So I'd be interested.
So basically you're saying you moved to Abington, it's better than Rockland, is that what you're saying? Okay, good, thank you. Thank you very much, Mary. Marianne, you want to say?
She gets my vote.
I'm very interested in the environment. I run a 4-H group. They've been here before.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, and I've had them involved, and I want to have them get more involved.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Well, the board have anything to add or make a motion?
Motion to accept the appointees to the SAGE committee.
Mary Breen, Bruce Krupnik, and Marianne Papacino to the SAGE committee. Motion is made. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, unanimous. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you for volunteering. Appreciate it. Why don't we go down to number 8 if it's all right? That's only going to take 30 seconds. Request to approve Little League Parade. The Little League officially begins its season each year with a parade and its opening ceremonies involving over 300 participants. The purpose of this letter is to formally request that the Abington Board of Selectmen approve a parade permit for Saturday, April 22nd, beginning at 11 o'clock. The parade will begin at the Abington Police Station parking lot on Central Street and proceed up Plymouth Street to Plymouth Street Field. I would like to take this opportunity to invite any members to join us along the parade route and to say a few words at the opening ceremonies. And I know Alex never misses an opportunity to speak into a microphone, so.
That's right.
That is from Robert Dawson, 139 Colonial Road.
My calendar now.
There you go. Do we have a motion?
We approve the Little League Parade on April 22nd, 2017, in coordination with the public safety.
What time was it?
11.
11 o'clock.
11 o'clock. Motion's made.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Unanimous vote. Okay, we're flying. Now I think we can do this. The Board of Selectmen will hold a public hearing on Monday, March 27th at 7 p.m. in the Carter Hearing Room, 500 Glenowitz Way, on the application of Michael Costa for an entertainment license on the outside patio of the Abington Ale House, 1235 Bedford Street. Is Michael Costa here? Or someone, come on up to the microphone if you could, please, and tell us a little bit about what you would like to do on the outside patio.
Well, the patio's been there, I think, about 11 years now or so, and we've never had any type of outdoor entertainment. We propose, we'd like to start slow, maybe do it on Sundays. Not talking nights, talking days, maybe a Sunday day, 12 to maybe 8, somewhere in there, just to get us through the lunch, dinner crowd. Not talking bands, talking more acoustical, singles, duos type of thing.
Okay.
We don't propose it to be loud. We don't propose it to be anything but a little bit of entertainment for outdoor guests and just during the months that the patio is open.
Okay. Any members?
What months are the patio?
I'm sorry?
The patio. What months is it open?
April through October. And I don't assume we'd do anything April, May. We're talking more summer months, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm.
But your application request, excuse me, just Sundays 1 to 8, correct? That's all
yes.
you're looking for at this point?
Yeah, yeah.
And just specify just acoustical as well.
Yep.
So.
Yes.
That's in the...
That's in the application.
It's in the left-hand column.
Okay. I just... Oh, go ahead.
Having known the deck and know the fireplace and know the bar, where did you think you would have the entertainers entertained from? Are they facing the street? Are they facing the parking lot? Are they in the rear, in the front?
Towards that end, most likely towards that end of the patio, towards the haunted house side, over in that corner over there.
Okay, because
because
you have the ramp coming
facing
up. You also
the bar,
have the service coming in and out of the
correct,
doors.
Yeah.
So, okay.
Now, have you spoken to any neighbors at all? About I know there's not that much, that many. There's a house across the street, right? And his house is in the
yeah,
back.
Yeah, Larry's here. So. Yeah, Larry's right across the street.
Okay.
Right. We sent out a list to all the abutters with a letter that says what we're doing. We didn't hear anything from anyone.
No, they'll have a chance. But, all right. Any other questions from the board? Come on up, Larry. If you could just state your name and address,
Lawrence
please.
Owens, 1250 Bedford Street.
Thank you.
Abington. I have a couple questions for Michael and Eddie. I'd like to know the size of bands they're going to have, the hours, and what days, or days or nights.
Okay. I think he just...
And the type of music they're going to have, that's all I want to know.
Okay. I think he just answered... You can tell him again if you want.
Sundays. We want to start slow. Sundays. See if it really works for us, if it's worth it. Only between the hours of 1 and 8. It wouldn't be 1 to 8. It would... Maybe we'll do 3 to... 7, maybe we'll do 4 to 7 or 8, that type of thing. Acoustical, no more than like a couple people.
Okay.
Acoustical music, not loud, and not no bands, no drums, that type of stuff.
Okay.
Just that answer all the questions.
Yes.
Just Sundays.
You can pay me later.
pay you later. Rhymes everything. So the entertainers would use their own speaker systems. They're not using anything off the wall or hanging off the curtain or nothing, right?
Nope, no.
Not doing
all portable stuff. Yeah.
Not color lights through the TV.
Oh God, no.
Okay.
Yeah, no.
All right.
Have you been to those places?
I've been everywhere. I'm not going to lie to you. I've seen it all. It's okay.
Yeah, I bet.
Does anybody else out there have any other questions or concerns? Members? Bob, you still have a...
No, I just, I welcome the entertainment. I think it'd be, I think I wish you well on that. I think it's a good idea. The fact that it's only Sunday, it's only 1 to 8, and you'll test it out and see what the flavor is, I think it's a really good idea. And I look forward to success, hopefully, for that project.
So you're making that motion?
I'm making that motion to accept.
Oh, we do have another comment, please. You missed your chance, but we'll give it to you.
You should have done it.
Bob Graham, 43 Vineyard Road. I heard him say he was going to try, you know, try just for Sunday, so if he wanted to expand that, would he have to come back to me?
Yes, he would. Because he put that right on, the hours and everything right in the...
Thank you.
The license.
Thank you. Thank you, yeah, thank you.
All right, once again, I'd like to...
Let me close, I'm going to, you can make a motion to close the hearing if you want.
Trying to speed up the process.
You're making a motion to close the hearing. Do I have a second?
Second.
Motion's made and seconded to close the hearing. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, now you can make your motion.
Motion to accept petition from Abington Ale House to have acoustical music from 1 to 8 on Sundays only be passed.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion? None. All in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous. Thank you. Congratulations. We'll be down.
Thank you very much.
Wow, every motion has been unanimous. And that cleans out the house pretty quickly. Let's say 7:10, but this...
The town clerk actually isn't here tonight.
So we can go through this one.
So this isn't really a legal appointment.
So you can talk about this?
Yes, yes. And she's just seeking to change the town election location back to the Abington High School. Primarily because there is actually a function the night at Emerald Hall at 7 o'clock, which doesn't technically interfere with the election per se, the town election, but it does create a little bit of a potential problem in terms of breakdown. And if there's any need for if there's a lot of write-ins, it could create a little bit of a problem in terms of the pressure that's put on the election staff. The high school is available. It's already booked, should the Board of Selectmen choose to go along with her recommendation. And because it's only a town election, there's no other, state or other elections, ballots, it shouldn't be any concerns about parking or traffic or anything else. And at this time next year, every other election from this point forward should be in the new facility, so it won't have to be moved again. So it would seem to be a good time to move it back to the high school permanently. So it's the town clerk's recommendation, and it would seem to be prudent to make the move now back to the high school. So that's our recommendation at this time. So.
What's the best way to advertise the fact that if this passes, that the people know that not to go to Emerald Hall, but to go to them?
Well, we do have to send a postcard to every home in town.
Would we include that in that language?
Well, you don't have to. A state statute requires it. So we will actually have to send a letter to a postcard to every home in town. And of course, it will be on the website, but any other... anything else that...
Could we use the police, the high school boards, and the Strawberry Valley boards to make that announcement also?
We certainly can do that, absolutely.
Okay. And have the police chief send
Nixle.
Out a notice.
We can certainly do that too, yes. Yep. Certainly, okay.
I'll entertain a motion.
Motion to approve the change of voting location to the Abington High School on April 29th, 2017.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous vote.
And just while we're on that, I don't know if I'm jumping out of line, but the last day to register to vote for that election is April 7th. So if you have not registered, please do so.
The next order of business is supposed to be 7:15. That's not a hearing. Can I bump that up or should I wait? Rick?
Abutters have not been notified for that. It's not required. It was not a public hearing.
All right, let's do that now then, if we can. 7:15, request for transfer of common how do you spell it? I just call it Vic.
Victual.
10:35, and that is Pazeng's, I believe. Do we have anybody here from you folks want to come up to the microphone and give your name and your address?
Why not? You involved? Come on up. We like to know everybody.
Now, is this new owners? That's what's happening? Yes? Okay. And you guys, I'm guessing, are brothers?
Yep, we're twin brothers, actually.
Twin brothers, Omar and Anwa?
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
And welcome.
Thank you.
So we're taking over ownership of this facility. Just for personal, are you taking the other one, too, that's in?
No.
Just this one?
Just this one, yeah.
Oh, okay. All right. Any questions from the board?
The current owner?
Yep, this is the current owner, John.
John?
I just want to say thank you.
Thank you, guys.
My son and daughter wouldn't be alive today without your pizza and chicken wings.
Thank you very much.
Just so you know, I just want you to know, that was, just consumed Friday night one more time, so.
Yeah, it's been a pleasure.
Does that create a conflict of interest for you, Paul?
Always, almost every weekly, by the way, but that's okay.
And I see in the notes you're not going to be doing alcohol there.
No.
Okay, so that will be, okay, that will be gone. I know you sell beer and wine there currently.
Yeah,
but
we don't sell much, so it's,
no. Okay.
It's not worth carrying over.
Yeah, I believe all the inspections have been done. I didn't see any issues. Questions from the board, Andy?
Going to keep the same name?
Yeah, we're keeping everything the same. We're going to just take his concept and just keep going with it. We love his wings, everything about it. We just love it. So we don't want to change anything, actually. So
no change in the hours of operation? These are the same hours
nope.
as they currently exist?
Okay. All the same.
Thanks.
Anybody else have any questions? If not, I'll entertain a motion.
Move we approve the request for transfer.
Second.
Motion is made and second. Any further discussion? None. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. No opposed? No. Nope. Unanimous vote. Congratulations.
Thanks, guys.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Good luck.
I appreciate it.
Good luck, guys. How are we doing for time? Pretty good, huh? All right. Next, we have, we're down to number five, correct?
Yes.
Jim Dombrowski, Surplus Land Committee, status update.
Come on down.
Mr. Dombrowski, welcome. If you can state your address, please.
You know where I live.
I know where you live.
28 Temple Street.
Yeah,
I don't know if you want to call this a status upkeep. Update or not, I guess we're reviewing information. Your last meeting, apparently a few selectmen had some questions as far as whether it be on the warrant or not for the town meeting. Back in December, Bob, I had issued five sheets of listings of property. And the one you should primarily concern yourself with is the one that says parcels declared surplus, final list, and it lists 55 properties. That's the only one that you would have to act on if you wanted to put anything on the town meeting warrant.
Just for that one?
Just for those
55
properties.
Yeah. Okay.
And like I said, the first two, it says map 20, but it's actually map 29 on those first two. So just make sure you have that correction. We had questioned the process of what would have to be gone through to dispose of the property. And I believe it's required that it be public auction. And I don't know whether Rick had gotten any information on that process or not.
I don't know. Did we pursue public auction?
Well, this would just put it on.
We had raised the questions whether or not, you know, the disposal of town-owned land has to go through town auction or an RFP process.
Well, the answer is yes, but it's a matter of decision up to the Board of Selectmen as to which you prefer, depending on the situation.
Okay.
But putting this on the town meeting is
just
to give us
surplus.
The okay
yes.
to do
yes,
it.
Yes, the town
yes.
meeting allows you the ability to dispose of it. Right.
And then we can figure out after town meeting how we're going to do it.
Whatever way they want.
Right. Right.
Now, in the past, you know, if you look at the list, you'll see on some of them it says 1999. Diane Circle Land and a few others were already declared surplus. All this does is just ties them all into one neat package under one list. So I believe someone was talking about possibly imposing restrictions on some of the land. I'd be hesitant about putting any restrictions on it at all. You have the town bylaws that apply. So, you know, I wouldn't restrict anything or say, you know, certain things that you can't do or can only do.
Would a buyer know that if it abutted conservation land or if it abutted, you know, wetlands, that they would have restrictions without having to tell them that?
maybe, maybe not.
Well, the restrict, depending on what they're planning on doing, if they're planning on expanding their land and they have wetlands, they would have to go before the Conservation Commission, if there's wetlands there.
Okay.
Majority areas up and around Diane Circle is, mostly involves wetlands. That's why we suggested half of it, everything from Jeremiah Sullivan Drive towards Beaverbrook, or basically westerly, be placed under the conservation. That's also in line with the Abington Open Space Plan also.
Okay.
Was that part of your recommendation, Jim?
Yes, yep. But the recommendation that we came up with at our last meeting of the Surplus Land Committee was that the list of 55 parcels be declared surplus.
Be declared surplus.
And you can go
so
forward.
So that doesn't include those that you're suggesting be given conservation restrictions?
Conservation needs to review that list.
So that's a separate list?
That was a separate list, yes.
Okay.
Yeah. There's no time restraints or anything on that. They can, whatever they want to do with it, whenever they want to review it. I have the entire packet of information on each and every property that we recommend to be placed into conservation.
So if we want to auction or whatever we do with this land, we want to get rid of this land over the next year, then we need to get it on this year's town meeting.
The first step.
The first step is to declare it surplus, and then you can move on from there. You can determine which way you want to go, whether it's an RFP or the public auction process, and also trying to generate interest from abutters or anyone who may be interested in it. I'm only aware of one parcel that was up in Diane Circle, and Alex, you had talked to him, but that he expressed interest.
Right.
Whether or not he can build a house on the lot, it's very possible. He would have to go through the permitting process to do it, though.
He's just looking to expand his yard, but
yep.
Yeah.
I mean, whatever process right. He goes through, I mean, if the road was able to be built, then you might have a few other house lots, but I don't think the road is in the possibilities of being built.
Most of these parcels of land are just little pieces that the only people that would be interested in are the abutters to expand their property.
Probably, yeah.
We have a few of them that, you know, like there's one of them up off of Washington Street. It's 11 acres. So, I mean, you're talking some of them that do have some size.
Yeah.
That one parcel that had 11 acres, maybe 50% of it was contained in the wetlands and the rest of it was upland. So within that right, you're talking, you still have wetlands to deal with. You would have to go before a Conservation Commission if you do anything within their jurisdiction. But you still have half of it as being potential, you know, developable or usable land.
And that has frontage?
I would have to go through the plans itself to determine whether it has frontage on it. I believe it does. We had a couple of them. One particular one that it would involve possible adverse possession. Years ago when the house was built, they actually built the driveway to it on town-owned property. And Andy, you can probably speak to cases like that. I don't know if you dealt with adverse possession, but for the past 15, 20 years plus, they've been using that property but not paying taxes on it. So that creates a unique situation.
That's a case where town may not make much money on selling the property, but it gets back on the tax roll, so you know, that happens to a couple.
The primary intent, my understanding when we created this committee, was to put these parcels back on the tax rolls, as many as we could. And that's where we come up with these 55 that are capable of doing just that. Some of them are small, some of them are, you know, good size.
So besides the 55 that we would want to vote to allow us to sell and the ones that can go to conservation, is there any other properties that we haven't made a decision with yet?
We have a list that we provided also in that when we're here of approximately, I believe it was 17.
We get the schools.
There was some properties that we did not take any action at all on.
Okay.
And if I remember right, I think it was either 14 or 17 parcels. 17 parcels.
Okay.
That we took no action on at all.
Okay.
Was there a reason for that?
We had no information to base anything on it. Unless we had more information that we could, you know, go out and do some research on or actually have to evaluate the property. That's why we just decided we don't have anything, we won't take any action at all on them.
Okay.
We decided that the two schools need a study committee of their own. Mm-hmm. And like I mentioned, the center school would have to be reviewed by Park and Recreation to determine whether they want the field and any additional land. There's 14 acres that belong to that school.
Yeah, because the field's down below. But
Murphy Field is down below and the school is up high and behind it.
Attached to that.
So that's a process that you would have to entertain bringing in the Park and Recreation and talking specifically about that and then subdividing it.
I mean, along with the smaller portions of property, there's some other portions that we discussed and everybody knows about it. It's the house on the golf course property. There's the old water building on Bank Street.
Bank Street.
Now, are they part of these 55?
Part of the,
yes,
part of the list, are, yes.
They're part of the 55, too. And there's the Boy Scout building, too, the property. So that,
no, we didn't take any action on the property for the West Abington Improvement Hall or Layla Field.
Okay, you're right.
That's not in the 55.
That's not in the 55. No. Neither is the 22 Bedford Street, the house lot that's part of the Strawberry Valley Golf Course.
Okay.
The reason being is both of those are considered protected recreational land. And until they determine, the Park and Recreation Commission decides that they no longer lead it and declare it surplus, we couldn't take any action on it.
So for purposes of this town meeting, we're looking just for the 55?
Just the list that I provided you,
yeah,
on those 55.
Can you get us that list again, Jim, just so?
Sure.
And maybe we can put it on the agenda
minutes,
for next meeting, Ken?
We have a copy. Well, I mean, we have a copy of the, we'll be happy to recirculate.
I can.
Yeah, and then maybe we can
look
at it next meeting and maybe take a vote on it.
But I think someone was concerned about getting something on this upcoming
town
meeting.
Yeah.
And basically, I mean, you could leave off Diane Circle, all those properties, because they already have been declared surplus. And some of them, they have the dates on them behind them, and there's North Quincy Street.
And I would want to just double check that
a declaration
of surplus is equivalent to an approval for dispossession. I believe it is, but I'd want to double check that too.
I believe that's what the original surplus land committee did back. I believe Roger Woods was the chairman of that committee at that time.
Okay.
And that's the process they went through.
Okay.
But I mean, declaring it surplus is one of many steps.
Yeah.
And we can always look at the list, and if it's something that you think is too controversial,
pull that off.
So
why don't we do that for the next meeting?
And during town meeting, if anyone on the town meeting floor can turn around and have XYZ property, you know, excluded, if they so want.
Maybe we can get together a map of the town, and we can just kind of maybe shade the portions that we're talking about, so we know, and then we can use that in further discussions too. Anybody else on the board have anything to add?
No, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Would you be available next meeting?
Yeah.
When we review that list, just in case we had.
If you decide to increase my budget.
No, that's not happening.
We'll double it.
I'll take the double.
Triple it.
I got a triple. You want a quadruple?
Take up a collection. Yeah.
Nothing from nothing still gives you nothing.
Exactly.
But yeah, I'll be there anytime you need information. If the Conservation Commission wants to go through and review that list, let me know. I'll be more than happy to bring all the facts. But if you bring in the school, you know, you want to talk about the center school, you know, be more than happy to give you what information I have on that.
Okay.
That shows the area.
Okay.
And the fact that the fire department has expressed interest in the North School. Now, that's something I don't know if you want to put both schools and have them declared as surplus now pending final release from the school department. That would speed up the process, or just wait, because you're going to have another, I'm guessing, about a year and a half before the school gets out of the north and center, thereabouts.
I don't want to predict.
Yeah. I mean, the letter they gave us said it would be about, you know, 2017, 2018 in that area. So whatever you want to do with that end, but definitely a study committee needs to be bringing in some more, you know, information that we couldn't get or generate.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Jim.
Thanks
Appreciate
very
it.
Much, Jim.
Thank
Jim,
you.
Jim, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Discussion item number 6, closed special annual town meeting warrants effective April 3rd, 2017. Rick, you want to?
No, that's just for the purposes of preparing a final warrant for acceptance and obviously for getting something to the Finance Committee for their final review. I mean, to the extent that most of the financial, the implications of the coming town meeting in May are together, that, you know, we're 99% there, but obviously the processing the town meeting takes some time and energy. So that's the date that we're recommending for everybody's benefit. So we've already more or less spread the word already. The town meeting warrant will be closed. For all intents and purposes, most people believe that it's the warrant articles have already been due, so, so the word will go forth.
So we don't have another meeting till after that, though?
Correct.
Do we want to put an article in, just hold the spot for this article for the surplus?
Yes, I mean, we'll...
Put a placeholder in there.
We're already put a, we'll be happy to do that, yes, so.
Any other discussion on the articles, on the warrants? Number seven, use...
Do you want to take a vote, Ken, to close it?
Do we have to take a vote?
Yeah, I think we should.
Yes, please.
Absolutely. Go ahead.
A motion that we close the special and annual town meeting warrants effective April 3rd, 2017.
Second.
Motion's made in second. Any further discussion?
Just with the amendment that we're putting a whole, we're going to put a warrant out for this special land sale for that.
For, right, for the annual town meeting warrant to...
To include the special land sale.
To include an article to declare the...
Surplus land.
Surplus land.
Yes, please. Thank you.
Yes.
Okay, all in favor of the amended motion?
Aye.
Okay, unanimous.
Just put that on the website, too, Dory?
Yes.
All right, number seven, used article license annual renewal. Please vote to approve the following used article and pawnbroker licenses listed below, pending receipt of all paperwork, satisfactory inspections, and up-to-date taxes. We have a review from Marshall Adams, building inspector. No violations were found, and then any violations were found, and a couple more were, every inspection was performed, so he has no issues. Chief Majenski reviewed the, has no objections to the reissuance. So, does anybody want to make a motion? Are you stepping down for one of these or not?
I'm going to step down for, can you exclude Fieldstone Furnishings?
I'm going to exclude Fieldstone Furnishings, so... Do you want to make a motion excluding that one, then?
Yeah, I'll make a motion that we approve Susie's Selections, Passion for Fashion, the Eclectic Selection, Collection, and ABC Tech Squad.
Second.
Motion made and seconded for those, the last four on the list. Any further discussion?
I don't seem to have the list, so, thank you.
Yes.
It just would be with all taxes and paperwork in order, contingent upon that.
Contingent upon that?
Pending receipt of all paperwork, satisfactory.
Okay, what I read, approve the following licenses pending receipt of all paperwork, satisfactory inspections, which has already been done, and up-to-date taxes. So that was the motion. We have a second. You all set, Bob?
Yes, I am, thank you.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That's unanimous. And then I will entertain a motion for Fieldstone Furnishings.
Motion to approve Fieldstone Furnishings, 538 Bedford.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Three and one abstention. Number nine, adoption of traffic rules pertaining to heavy commercial vehicles on Orange Street. This is in reference to town's recent request for a heavy vehicle commercial exclusion on Orange Street. Please be advised that our District 5... approval of excluding vehicles over 2.5 tons carrying capacity on Orange Street. We have to vote on this, and then we have to sign a bunch of documents. And there'll be, do they put the signs up, or do we put signs up? How does that work?
The town will do that, right. As you know, this was requested by the board some time ago, and with the help of Old Colony Planning Council, we had to engage in a study to prove that it that the request met the requirements, state requirements, that it was being adversely impacted by heavy equipment as a cut-through for heavy vehicles. And they were engaged in a traffic study that was submitted to the state, verified that it met the conditions, and as you can see, it was approved. And as the next step is for the board to adopt an appropriate regulation, traffic regulation. And as simple as it seems, this is very in line with local communities, towns, what they adopt for similar regulations. So we are effectively using a template that's used by many of our neighbors for doing the same thing. So once this is sent to the state and they verify that this is indeed appropriate, we will go about the business of putting up appropriate signage here on both ends of the street. So
right, let me read that so we have it on record. heavy commercial vehicle exclusion, it's called HCVE. No vehicle in excess of 2.5-ton capacity shall be operated on Orange Street in the town of Abington, with the exception of those vehicles making deliveries. Those vehicle making deliveries upon completion shall proceed immediately to either Bedford Street, Route 18, or Washington Street to continue the next destination. Voted this 27th day of March 2017. I will entertain that motion.
Make that motion.
So we have a motion.
Second.
We have a second. Is there any further discussion? Anybody want to talk more about it? We're all set. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous.
Thank you.
Town manager's report.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Couple brief updates here. Number one, this past week we did meet with gentlemen and engineers who are maybe making a proposal to us for bringing in some fill, contouring and shaping our landfill, and perhaps performing a capping project. And in fact, tomorrow morning they'll be walking the landfill to see what our composting situation is like, because of the moving that could be a real challenge. And so for the if we're, there's going to be an RFP of sorts, including that in the an RFP is going to be important. So as is indicated in my written update to you, this is likely going to have to be a bid project, or an RFP rather, and one of the major conditions here is that there's some clean area up there. The capacity to use that clean area for capacity is a very important component here in terms of the economic viability. Steve Wright is working with is exploring that through DEP to determine if that is viable. And Steve is going to be outlining for me, and obviously for the Board of Selectmen, the steps to go through to determine, to give us guidance to go forward if we'd like to proceed with this type of project. He did mention to me, and some of you may recall, was well before my time, that approximately a dozen years ago there was a similar deliberation. There's a public involvement process that's required in the regulations for a project like this to go forward. There was a public hearing, or a public involvement process, not really a public hearing per se, that included the selectmen and the Board of Health. And at that time, the powers that be, after a public involvement process, did determine that there was some value in pursuing this type of project. It never came to pass for various reasons, because there wasn't any requirement for the town to specifically cap the landfill. So there was some public support at that time for potentially exploring this type of project. So so we'd have to engage in that again pursuant to the regulations, DEP regulations. So he's going to be outlining the process for us again. So very possible that there's some real viability here. So I'll be getting that to you as soon as Steve produces that for me. So, but again, tomorrow morning there will be a site walk by the potential vendor here. So again, we'll keep you updated. It comes up the issue of whether or not that particular area that's not currently landfill space per se is it can be utilized for this purpose. So that's kind of a key element here. So that right now is between Steve Wright and DEP. So,
and who makes that determination? DEP?
DEP will be the determining body, and Steve's being cautious how he approaches that. So next item here, the town charter, the issue that never dies. Our state senator and state rep have been in contact with the governor's office, and the governor has agreed to file a governor's bill. And I don't pretend to be extremely proficient with the legislative process when it's but the they he has agreed to file a bill to correct the legislative error, I guess, that you'd say that has occurred. As you know, that the charter update that previously was completed by the town, which was already approved locally, there were some requirements that that had to be approved at the state level, which was done, but that was when it was completed, it was subject to local approval, which had already been completed. So so to go through the local approval process again would be again duplicative, is that the right word, if I say it slowly? So the governor has agreed to file a bill. Lauren Goldberg is drafting legislative language at the request of the governor's office and our legislative contingent to accomplish that. So hopefully that will be done in the very near future and acted upon. So keep you informed of that. I know
by the time they finish it, we'll have to do another 10-year review.
Well, I know that. And again, you know, Mr. Buckley, who was the chairman of the charter, I want to say was the chairman of the charter review committee, but it could be is the chairman of the charter review committee. It's hard to know if it's past tense or not. You know, obviously speculated that we should just, you know, put it on on the ballot, but again, what happens if there's a fluke and it doesn't pass? What happens? We've been operating under a certain charter.
I was thinking the same thing, but what happens if it passes? Do you still have to go back to the legislature and let them know that it
passed? No, the legislature said that we had to vote in 2017 on it.
Well, it says subject to local acceptance, but it's already been
locally accepted. It was accepted.
So again, the goal is to have it corrected.
What is the harm if it did fail?
Well, do we have a DPW?
Yeah, but we're gonna.
We have issues of jurisdictions, whether it's your sewer departments, sewer commissioners, Board of Health. We've got issues of authority in this town that.
But how does everything stand now with the legislature saying that it has to be voted, and what if it takes the governor a year to get it? Are we in limbo now? The same thing?
I'm told this should take a matter of weeks for the governor to be filing a bill.
That's what we thought 2 years ago.
I'm just telling you.
I think we're still operating under the prior charter at this point in time. Not the revised charter, because that hasn't been approved at this point. So
yeah.
Well, we did make the DPW stuff has been adopted, so that was in that other.
Well, that's
that
right.
Was in
charter.
The
well, that's
yeah.
right. Well, so this is the question. It's also been incorporated, and it's also been incorporated into
this
the
10-year
update language.
Right.
So, what happens if the language of the new charter isn't adopted under the what kind of? It's just a lot neater if the language that was incorporated in the nice, neat bonnet of the 10-year charter review is adopted in the bill filed by the governor. It's just a lot neater. And so I wish I had all the answers, but the correction that would be filed by the governor in a governor's bill drafted by town council would be the neatest way to have this completed. So.
Where do we, well, I guess the other question was, have the ballots already been printed for the town election at
this
point?
Well, no, that's why it's coming up tonight.
So,
if it's going to be on the ballot, we have to know tonight.
Tonight would be the last day.
Yeah.
So, moving on. As you know, accompanying my report was some comments from your appointee to the Union Point, the advisory committee, Joe Shea, and I don't know if you had a chance to review them yet, but just one piece of info that the comment period has been pushed back to a date in April, which I actually had attached up. It's actually in Mr. Shea's notes. So if you haven't had a chance to review that very significant document, you do have some additional time. and I have that date, and I'm having a tough time putting my finger on it at the moment, but it is a date in April.
So this is Joe Shea's comment?
These are his comments, yes. And within his comments...
And he has some valid concerns.
Yes. And again, they're obviously the concerns that you would expect, and most of them the same concerns, obviously, that, you know, you would expect to...
I'm sorry, Rick, what's the deadline, the date?
Yeah, I'm...
Looking for it now.
I'm looking, it's right here, it's, as I said, sorry, Bob, I thought that I had specifically... Underline that. I will...
Oh, it's not tomorrow.
No, it's a date in April. I believe it's like April 21st or...
Okay.
I will circulate that specifically, but I believe it's April 21st. So you... two other quick issues. One that Andy had specifically requested. One update, especially after this last, I hesitate to call it a storm, but snow and ice budget. We are currently over by about $398,000, keeping in mind that $80,000 of that is the fifth and final year of that five-year snow deferral. So I hate to say not bad. It's actually reasonably good considering our five-year average overdraft is approximately $500,000. So we're actually not in a bad spot. And considering $80,000 of that is the last of our that five-year deferral. And Poa Recce property that the state has reserved approximately $50,000 to purchase from the town. As I mentioned to Andy, I do have to get a better update, but as of the beginning of February, there was the title issues with the property. It prevented the town, the state from actually purchasing it from the town. The town, as you know, has approved the sale of it. There was some ownership issues within the Poa Recce property that has created some deeds, some title issues. Town council has had conversation and worked with the attorney for the DCR, and DCR was working on doing some title work. Obviously, I tried not to get town council any more involved with title work as possible, just for our own budgetary sake. But I have not, within the last several weeks, spoken to either DCR's attorney or town council, so I will get a better update as to where that stands. Obviously, that would be a nice for those of for people's recollection that particular property is almost is entirely encircled by Ames Noel State Park, that piece of property, most of that property. So I think the attorney actually for the state is Attorney Arthur George, who's a fairly local attorney.
Is it really? Yeah.
From, I think he's Holbrook.
Holbrook, yeah. Right,
yeah. Mm-hmm. Who now works for DCR.
So. I didn't know that.
So if you know him.
I do know.
Closely enough, you might actually get a better, quicker update than I might. So.
His father's
father. Yeah.
There's always something else, but I can't remember. I think that was...
Bob?
So Rick, going back to number one, the Abington landfill.
Yes.
When they came back to you, were they saying that the frontage part where we're using that we're doing for the Abington's use is now under plausible scope of being used as part of the capping scope? The compost site?
No.
Is that part of the is the company looking to do this, Mr. Carney?
Well, they would like
proposing plausibly using the compost site area as part of the capping area.
Yes.
Well, the answer is yes. The concern is from our standpoint is where would we move a composting operation to, and that's why they're taking a site walk tomorrow to see if there's a plausible way to incorporate the composting operation post closure. Still at the general footprint of the overall location. So
I called Mr. Carney and told him that we don't have a place to move it. So is going to have to take a look at it and see if they can work around it.
Okay, but when we looked at this 6 or 7 years ago, we looked at the plausible things of playing fields and capping it over. I think we all, well, I think the town was in agreement back then that we needed to have some place to do our composting.
Right.
And that finding another space in the town to do that was difficult at best.
It's a challenge.
Then it's probably even more now. So I just want to speak to the point where I'm really adamant about trying to keep a compost site process. And I know, having been with the Board of Health, how difficult it is to roll all the leaves and stuff we gather over to get the right type of compost we want to give out and make sure it gets done right, and we need the distance and the, so maybe, I understand what he's coming at, but I just want to go on record as saying that is something that's very important to me, that we keep in some way, shape, or form, and sure, if there is some way of doing it post-haste, but I fairly confident that the state was really adamant that if we were going to do anything in that area, it's all encompassing part of the capping, and you would not be allowed to use that property after the fact of capping it. So that's, I remember that conversation specifically from Stephen Wright's conversation, the presentation in this room several years ago. So I don't want to lose that. That's all I'm saying is that,
sure,
if he's looking for more space, I understand what he's looking for. He's going to get that acreage to do more work from. But I think we have to be cautious at best with whatever he wants to do. Right. And wear your boots, because there's some soggy points out, yeah, there.
Well, no,
he totally understands that that's where the town wants to keep it.
Well, I think that comes to the viability of the site with this other area, the acreage up there that's not currently landfill space per se. There's a so. But again, the challenge is not ours to determine if it's a viable location. It's
no,
would
it's,
be his. And then again, ultimately, it's a, you know, it's a procurement proposition. And you know, I think the advantage for all of us is we're learning whether this is viable. Whether we, you know, that's, you know, we're kind of in the catbird seat. So,
okay. Thank you.
I actually have one question, and I don't want to drag this meeting on. Union Point. Now, we went to a meeting over there, was it like two weeks ago? But that wasn't what we thought it was, right? That was about an EPA something or chemicals that they want to use. Just, I mean, but what is it they want comments on?
They want comments on the notice of project change, which is that, you know,
summary
139-page document.
We never received. Or did we get an email?
Yes, yeah. We did.
We did get an email.
Okay. And
yes,
there's disk available.
Yeah, I have a disk if you'd like it, or I can print out a hard copy if you'd like, which is significant. But whichever you prefer.
Now, do we have? Let's see. I'm not going to say I'm an expert when I look at this. Do we have experts or someone that knows what to look for in these things and make comments? Obviously, Joe Shea has taken the time to look at it, and he's got some valid concerns. But do we have experts or planners or people that in the know look at it?
Well, we don't. And that's, you know, presumably that's why it goes to the Executive Office of Environmental Affairs, and they're supposed to be the experts that... but they're not advocates for the town of Abington, if that's, and I know, you know, that's why it's a challenge. That's, you know, we don't have independent engineering staff or planning staff to do that.
Now, when you talk about some of the stuff that the concerns that Joe has raised are about water and traffic and that sort of stuff, does that all fall under the auspices of the Executive Office of Environment, even the traffic and stuff?
Not so much the traffic, but certainly the water does.
Okay, I don't.
The change, I've only highlighted the CD, and the change is, there's a lot of meat in this document. It's not like a black and white thing you have to read.
It seems like it changes every month too.
Yeah, and but this is I think, and you got a hard copy of it, right?
Yes.
It's not a thin packet.
No.
And as you just said, we're not experts, and reading some of this stuff is not
right
for the average human being to say, I get that, that's no problem at all.
Right.
But there's a lot in that document. And to say that even the five of us could even if we took sections, could come back and have logical, probably not. And whether or not we could find someone who would be the right person to review this for the town without going crazy on cost and stuff like that.
And I know the planning board is reviewing this. I know.
So it's going to, I would put it out to as many different departments as possible.
Right. And
public safety, all that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And have them just.
Especially now we have more time.
Yeah,
yeah, definitely.
Yes, it's been widely distributed to agencies as well as the ESA, as well as the.
But have you heard from anybody except for Joe Shea?
Yeah.
I'm sorry?
Have you heard from anybody else except for Joe Shea about it?
I haven't had feedback from anybody yet. No.
Could you ask the other departments to, if they have feedback, to if they could get back to us at our next meeting?
We can do that, yes.
Because if they tell us to look for something, at least we'll know what we're looking
right.
for.
Because
yeah.
each department might have different concerns.
And it
if,
just it, seems
if
like
it, this is the 21st and we meet on the 10th, then we would need their feedback by then, if we're going to prepare a letter or a response.
I mean, I've offered to everybody that I will certainly be happy to be a clearinghouse of any comments to get any of those comments to EOEA by the deadline.
And I guess there's two ways we could comment. We could comment each individually, or we could comment together.
Yeah.
As a board as well. And maybe you want to put it on the agenda for the next meeting, just in case.
Discussion.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Can we do that? Discussion, and I'll take a copy of it, I guess, and have my 2 cents worth, but I'll take pages 1 through 100.
Yeah, I know.
All right.
Oh, you take the easy pages, sure.
Here's the table of contents. Does anybody else know? There's nobody in the public audience, so I'm guessing there's no public comment.
Bill,
oh,
might
Bill,
have
I'm
a
sorry.
Comment.
You want to talk?
Bill, yeah.
All right. Yes, go ahead.
I just have a concern and a comment. I was driving down 58, and there's a business on the right that has the easement that accesses the Weymouth Bates property. There's a gate there, but the crossover that the oil coal tar company on the right hand side of 58. There's a tractor trailer out there, and there's a gate behind the second building, and then there's an easement across the track. And I believe that's an easement for us to access the Weymouth, South Weymouth Interface mm-hmm. property if we needed to. I just didn't know what access rights we have to get to that point, because I don't think you could get a vehicle to it today if you needed to, and I don't want to speak to the property owner and what he has right to not right to do. I was just asking where. When have we ever used it, or do we ever use it, or do we ever even validate what happens when you get out to the other side of the tracks? Where do you go? Because it seems like it's overgrown with trees. I don't know if it was anything we had worries or concerns about, that if we ever had to get an emergency vehicle over it, what are our rights to do that? I'm not quite sure.
I think that was brought up by the fire chief when we were discussing fire access there, and it would need quite a bit of modification, but we do have the right to go across there, but I don't believe it's suitable to go across now, obviously.
Okay.
But that might be a location at some
future
point, I think the chief said.
Okay.
But that would be, in my opinion, on Southfield to build that road if necessary.
Really?
I was just from the point of having access to that point. I didn't think, and it changes when you go by that what he has there, but
yeah.
I've gone by a couple of times in the last couple of weeks, and I didn't think a fire engine could get through that to the gate, let alone get across the property to get to that property.
And what I understand, we do have a right of way through there, but
okay.
it's not
I
suitable.
I thought I'd ask the question, no. so.
Well, if we want to push the issue, then we could ask them to cut down the brush in case there is, if they want to help put out a fire on that portion of the, you know, I mean, that's up to.
If that's our only other access point and we needed other than the main access point, I just don't know where that responsibility falls and where our access points are and whether or not we could, but I don't think it would, I think you could probably get the pickup truck with the branch truck or the
brush
truck through it. I don't think you could get a fire pumper through it, let alone the ladder truck if we needed to, so. And I don't know what would you would do on the other side of it, because it seems to have overgrown.
Right.
I just thought I'd bring it up as a point of, not as a point of interest, just to see what we should be doing, or if you were doing anything at all, as we talk about the development of the base, because it's, as things could happen, as the trails open up down there, as they said at our last meeting, they are going to have walking trails and stuff, running trails and bike trails.
They've got them already, yeah.
They've got them all.
And if you need emergency access to get there, how are we going to get there if we needed to, God forbid, so. I just thought I'd bring it up as a point of interest, so. I'm all done.
You sure?
Nope, I could go on if you want me to, but I got some other ideas.
All right, if no one has anything else, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you.